Thanks, Ricardo. And thanks everyone for joining us today. As Ricardo mentioned, Professor Mark Hayter is Chair in Sexual and Reproductive Health and Head Department of Nursing at the University of Hull in the UK. He's also an honorary professor at the Hong Kong Polytechnic University and has extensive academic contacts in Asia, Australia, the Middle East, and the United States. Mark's research includes national and international collaborations, including EU and UK Department of Health projects on a variety of sexual health topics. Mark's current research includes an NIRH Research for Patient Benefit grant to study the prevention of repeat unplanned pregnancy in new teenage mothers. He is also involved in sex education and school nursing research in Taiwan, Egypt, and Hong Kong. He has been closely involved in sexual and reproductive health research and practice for over 20 years and has published extensively. Mark is also an active researcher in the area of psychosexual health. He specializes in qualitative research methods and has a particular interest in grounded theory, but is also experienced in phenomenology, case study, and ethnographic work. He has published over 30 qualitative research papers, as well as writing numerous editorials on qualitative research. Mark has also delivered writing for academic publishing workshops in China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, Australia, Thailand, Finland, United States, Brazil, and South Africa. Mark, thank you very much for being here today. You can go ahead.
Okay, Mark, I will now make you the presenter, and now it's all on you, okay? Thank you. Okay, Mark, go ahead. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead now.
Okay. Thank you. Well, hello, everybody. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to present this seminar. It's evening here, but it may be morning or afternoon where you are. And thank you, Yvette, for the kind introduction. What I plan to do is to share the benefits of my experience, both as a qualitative author but also as an editor of the Journal of Advanced Nursing, to discuss some practical things about writing qualitative papers and share with you some of my experiences and give some hints and tips about writing qualitative papers for journals, but also spend a bit of time talking about writing papers with an international perspective. I'm looking forward to speaking to you for about 35 to 40 minutes, and then also looking forward to taking your questions later on. One of the things I'd like to start with is just some general broad advice, some basic points, but very important none the least. And one of my tips for writers, whatever type of study they're doing, is always write for a specific journal. Always have a journal in mind when you're writing a paper. If you write a paper and then look for a specific journal to publish in it, you will always end up having to do more reformatting, rewriting. So it's always important to select the journal that you're targeting your paper on and write specifically for that journal. And that's partly what I mean by doing your homework on the journal. Find out about the journal that you're interested in and ask yourselves a number of questions. For example, does this journal publish many qualitative papers? Thankfully, qualitative research is much more generally widely accepted now, but there are some journals who tend to publish more quantitative, positivist work and don't publish many qualitative papers. You can either be brave and decide to be the first author to publish a qualitative paper in that journal, or you can play safe and find a journal that you know is going to be receptive to your qualitative research paper. So find out about the journal and write specifically for that journal. And that's what I mean by follow the style carefully. It's very important that you format your qualitative papers according to that journal style. Now, that does two things. One, it means that your paper won't get rejected because it's not followed the right format, of a paper in that journal. But the other thing it does is it makes the paper look like a paper in that particular journal. As an editor, I know that we get a very quick chance to review a paper before we decide to send it out to review. And one of the things I think that subconsciously helps editors make that decision is what the paper actually looks like. If the paper looks like a paper in their particular journal, it's formatted correctly, it uses the same font headings, the same bold or italic scripts, I think that's a very, very important thing to do, to get past that first hurdle of an editor reviewing your paper very quickly. What it looks like is quite important. And lastly on this slide, and I make no apology for saying this, and I'll probably repeat it many times, is that it's important that you read and adhere to the author guidelines. One of the most common reasons that papers are rejected are that they fail to meet the journal guidelines. So read these, look at these, and look, many journals now have specific and very detailed advice on how to publish and structure a paper. I know my journal and many others also give a guide format for qualitative research papers around the style of the paper, but also what subsections and in what order they should exist within the paper. So make sure, whatever I'm saying to you this evening and giving you hints and tips, that you always make sure you read and adhere to the author guidelines. That's extremely important. One of the other things that I think is important with writing any paper, but with qualitative papers particularly, is the nature of the title. My advice is try to keep the title as short as possible and always try to mention the method and make some reference to the research question in the title. And there are some examples here. One of the things that this does is enhance the discoverability of your paper. And of course, one of the things we're all interested in is people finding our papers, reading our papers, but above all, citing our papers. As authors, we all want that to happen. So on the matter of titles, and I think qualitative writers are particularly guilty of this, try to avoid very, very long titles. They can be confusing and they can affect discoverability. Also, try to avoid titles that include extracts of data within them. Sometimes qualitative researchers like to start their title off with a cryptic use of a phrase or a sentence mentioned by one of the participants, maybe in their interviews or focus groups. I don't think this helps. I think it confuses readers and it doesn't it affects discoverability to the contrary. So try to avoid using data in titles. And also, qualitative researchers seem to enjoy either using cryptic, in other words, mysterious titles or humorous titles. I would advise not doing either and go for simplicity. A humorous title may seem hilarious to us, but it doesn't travel, humor doesn't cross national boundaries very well. And of course, once you've written the title of a paper, for the rest of your life, you can't change it. And humor changes. So stick with a title that is simple, focused on the methodology, and has some element of the research question present within it. What I want to do now is go through the structure, the basic structure of a paper. I accept that journals will offer different structures, but basically this follows the research process that we are all familiar with. And most journals proceed in this kind of way. So what I intend to do is talk a little bit about each of these sections of a paper and make specific reference to qualitative papers and qualitative research. So let me start with the introduction. Now, an introduction is a very important piece of a paper, and my advice is keep it brief, 150 to 200 words, but that clearly highlights the research topic, its importance, and what the research question is. Also, reinforce that this is a qualitative study in the introduction and specify the qualitative approach to be used. Again, editors, will often read the introduction and quickly scan a paper before they decide it may be something that they want in their journal. So the introduction is very, very important. In my journal and many other journals, we specify a separate introduction section. Some journals don't. They start with just a background or literature review section. My advice is for papers, for journals that don't ask for a specific introduction, still write the first paragraph of that background section as you would do so an introduction. Just don't label it an introduction if the journal doesn't want. So it's very important that your introduction gets over your research question, the importance of that topic, and also that there's a qualitative approach that's going to be used. Following that, the most traditional structure would ask you for a background or a literature review. And I think this is where the justification for a qualitative approach should begin. It's very important that the existing literature on a topic is covered. But when doing that, I think with a qualitative paper, it's important to highlight not only the knowledge, but maybe methodological gaps, and emphasize the necessity to gain an in-depth experiential knowledge of the particular issue or topic in this particular section. So not only highlight the literature, but if the literature is mainly surveys and quantitative data, highlight the methodological gap and start to emphasize the importance and relevance of using a qualitative approach for your particular paper. Your literature review should lead the reader logically to your aim or your research question. Many journals ask for this as a specific short section, and it should actually be the shortest section of your paper. Make sure that the aims and objectives of the study are clearly written and concisely written. Brevity is the watchword for writing this section of a paper. Try to use bullet points if the journal format will allow. I think it's very important that for qualitative researchers, we don't wrap our research question up in a lot of narrative, where the reader has to read and reread a passage to actually find out what our research question actually is. Don't use narrative in this section. Use very clear language, simple language, bullet points if possible, and make it short. Following the aim section, of course, we move on usually to the methodology section of the paper. Now, what I like to do is I like to split this section of the paper up into two particular parts. So I call the first part methodology one. And I think in that part of the paper, it's important to justify and discuss the rationale for choosing qualitative research to address the chosen subject. Draw on your research question and literature review to argue the need for an in-depth or exploratory approach in the first part of this section. Use some general qualitative references to support your particular point. Once you've done that, I think you can move on to what I call methodology two, which is where you explain and justify your choice of qualitative approach. For instance, grounded theory, phenomenology, which school are you using, which type of approach are you using? And I would also say, don't be afraid to do what could be called a straightforward thematic analysis. Qualitative research does not have to be complex to provide meaningful data and meaningful results in a qualitative paper. And what I would say here, and that's related to that point, is don't say you've done a phenomenological analysis or a grounded theory study when you haven't. So don't dress up a straightforward thematic or content analysis as anything other than that, because that will influence reviewers and it will also influence editors. So if you have done or you're saying you're doing a grounded theory or phenomenological study, make sure that's what you do. And that sounds obvious, but occasionally we do see papers where they've said they're doing a grounded theory or phenomenological work, and then when you look at it, the analysis is just a thematic analysis or a straightforward content analysis. Don't be afraid to do something like that. Following the methodology, it's around how we collect and recruit to our study, how we collect data. And I think it's important in this section to think about two things. And I actually like to separate these out. So make sure you're clear about the sampling procedures in qualitative research. So for the first part of this section, I think it's very important that the type of sampling is used. Justify the approach. Make sure you're familiar with the qualitative literature on sampling and use some references to support the type of sampling you've used. In a way, think of that part of this section as the theory. Then, and I think it's important these two sections aren't mixed up, then talk about the sampling and recruitment procedure. And that's what I call the process. And I think those two are best off separated and work in that order. The theory of sampling first with supporting references, then the sampling or recruitment procedure following that. Then we're often asked to describe our sample. And here I think language is important. I appreciate that people differ, but generally I think we need to humanize the people we collect our data from. The most commonly used word, and the word that I find most useful, is participants. I think it's very helpful not to refer to the people we're collecting data off as qualitative researchers as subjects. Respondents is a little bit better, but I think phrasing and using the term participants is something that I would recommend. The other thing that I will be saying to you for the first time now, but also in a few moments' time, is qualitative researchers don't make as much use of tables in their papers as I think they could do. Now, obviously, those of you who are writing qualitative papers for journals know that 5,000 words, 6,000 words, sometimes 7,000 words is still not enough, or we would like more. Qualitative researchers would always like more words to use. But often journals, in fact, most journals stipulate a word limit. If we can use tables, that's a good way of saving words. And one way to do that is instead of providing a large narrative piece in your paper that describes your participants, why not use a table? Use pseudonyms and then use demographic data to populate the table with your participants, who they are, what their pseudonym is. Obviously, you use pseudonyms and not real names, how old they are, other information that readers might want to know. Instead of writing that in your narrative, you can put it in a table and it saves you words. And it's also very useful for doing something which I'm going to be talking about later on with the data that you've actually got when you present your findings. So use a table for participants. All research has ethical dimensions. Qualitative research is no different. Obviously, in addition to the usual ethical issues in any research project, such as informed consent, etc., and obviously being clear about the ethical approval that's been obtained for the project and which ethical review board has given you permission, etc., think about specific qualitative research issues around ethics. So, for example, have you discussed and have you made the reader aware that you had a mechanism within your study for protecting participants if they become emotionally upset or anxious during the data collection phase? And what strategies did you have if people who you were collecting data from did get upset? This is particularly important in research, qualitative research, that is used to uncover information about quite sensitive issues, end-of-life care, sexuality, for example. And also make sure that you are clear about the confidentiality duty that you owe your participants, and this would be the point you would reiterate that any mention of participants' names, of course, will be a pseudonym to protect their identity. When we move on to the data collection section, again, it sounds straightforward, but ensure that this is congruent with your chosen methodology. Make sure you've used the right kind of data collection to your chosen methodology, be it phenomenology or grounded theory. Quite often I come across grounded theory papers that have not used, for instance, the appropriate sampling or congruent data collection, data analysis, etc. You might want to discuss here why you've chosen to do interviews rather than focus groups, for example. Use the literature around that to explain that choice. What type of interviews and what will you ask participants? And again, this is another opportunity to use a table. I'm a big believer in qualitative researchers being as clear as possible about their data collection techniques. So why not use a table to list the interview questions that you used together with the prompts you used on an interview schedule? I think that can be very useful and very interesting for readers to get a good sense of the kind of things that you were asking if you were doing interviews. And of course, we need to discuss data analysis. And I think it's very important that we keep the description clear and in keeping with the methodology. So try to give examples of how themes were constructed or theories generated. And I think, again, we can use tables and figures to save words and provide clarity. So just a couple of examples now from some work that I've done around sexual health. The topic of the research is almost irrelevant. What this table does is, of course, save us words, and don't forget how important that is for qualitative researchers. This is an example from a grounded theory study, and you can see here that what I've done is to aid the description of how data was subject to open coding. In a table, what I've done is provided an extract from the data at the left, and then the open codes on the right side of that table. This table obviously is not included in the word count, but it speaks volumes and helps me explain the analytical techniques that otherwise might take up a number of words. What it also does is, I believe, enhances the rigor of the paper by allowing the reader, obviously, not to look at all your data and all your coding, but at least it offers a chance to for readers to judge the rigor and completeness of your analysis. And when you're doing thematic or grounded theory or any research that involves building data from extracts and coding like this to larger themes, here again is an example of a table that I put in a paper which shows the relationship of open codes during grounded theory to a substantive code. Again, a table saves so much time, and as a visual demonstration of the analytical process, I think it's much better than trying to describe this in a lot of text. The other thing about data analysis is make sure you have a separate section for dealing with the procedures you used for qualitative rigor. My journal and many others actually ask for a specific subsection in the paper following the analysis on rigor. This section needs to be clearly written, briefly written, but I think it's a very important area. And of course, this is something that is very difficult to do after you've done the study. So it's very important when qualitative projects are planned that within the data analysis, the techniques for establishing trustworthiness or rigor are actually built in to the data analysis processes. It's very difficult to apply these techniques retrospectively once you've analyzed your data. So if there isn't a separate section asked for, make sure you probably close your data analysis section with a few sentences or a paragraph or so about qualitative rigor. When you're doing that, make reference to the literature on qualitative rigor and trustworthiness in qualitative analysis. qualitative authors are getting better, and the majority of papers I now see do have a discussion about the techniques used to enhance rigor. Where they often lack is linking those techniques to references. So make sure that the reader is not only clear what techniques to establish rigor you used, but that you reference the qualitative literature that they came from. Be explicit about the techniques used. Try not to be vague. So are they intended to, for example, establish credibility, help with confirmability, strengthening the dependability, etc. So be clear what the techniques are designed for. And of course, remember that the literature and the techniques used by qualitative researchers to enhance the rigor of their analysis is a growing body of knowledge. You cannot possibly use all the potential rigor techniques in your study. So it's important that you make sure you use some, they're appropriately used, and you make reference to the literature. The findings are obviously one of the most important parts of any paper, and that is the same for qualitative papers. My feeling is that this should be a narrative that uses data as an illustration within the story that you're telling. So you're telling a story using the data almost as you would references to support a narrative argument or a discussion. And a good qualitative finding section should actually be able to be read through missing out the data, and it should still make sense. It should still flow. When you're writing your findings, think about how themes and categories are linked to plan the order of the findings section. Be logical and think about how this section actually flows, how it comes together. Think about the holistic story you're trying to tell in this particular section. And again, make sure that this section looks right on paper. And here's an example. And what I mean is that as qualitative researchers, we need to make sure that the findings section we write in our papers has a good balance between us, the author, and the data. If I see a paper where there are lots and lots of data extracts and hardly anything from the author, I wonder about how they're going to knit that narrative together and make a good description of their findings. Conversely, if I see lots and lots of narrative from the author and hardly any data, I begin to wonder how they're going to support their narrative with extracts from their data. As qualitative researchers, we know that our story that our research is telling hangs on the quality of our data, and it's important that we ensure that we get across the quality of that data to the readers. So how the research looks on paper, how the findings look on paper, can be quite important, or on the screen, of course. Here I'll also point out, you can see that here's my narrative, and then there's some data in italics. There's several things I want to make a point about here, is when you're writing for a specific journal, I'll take you back to what I said earlier on at the start of my seminar. Make sure that you adhere to the guidelines. Look at a qualitative paper in the journal you're interested in. How are they presenting their data? That will have been through the editors. That will be the paper that you see in the journal will be how the journal wants it. So have they used italics? Have they indented the quotes of data that you're using? Have they used a smaller font size, for example? If they do, you do it. Mimic how that journal presents a findings section. Do the same things for yours. You'll also see that there are pseudonyms here of Harry and Andrew. And of course, they're not the real names. But I think it's much more human to use pseudonyms than it is to use numbers or letters or something like that. We must remember that qualitative research is a humanist endeavour, and that we need to remember that we're talking about people when we are reporting our data. One of the other important things about writing the findings section of a qualitative paper is to ensure that we clearly label the data sources, to ensure that the data extracts are from across your sample. One of the things I look for in qualitative PhDs or qualitative papers is, can I cross-reference the data in the findings section to the sample? And if you recall, I mentioned using a table of demographics when you're describing the sample. What this allows you then to do is, when you're reporting your data in the findings section, for instance, if we think about the name I used earlier, Andrew, a reader should be able to see that data extract is from a quote that Andrew says. What I should be able to do as a reader is to go back to the table and see who Andrew is, how old he is, how long has he been ill, for example, or all sorts of demographic information. So it brings the data alive. We can see and understand what that person is and what their demographics are and learn something about them when we look at the data. So that's one important thing, and that's one thing a helpful table using pseudonyms can allow us to do. Cross-reference our data to our demographics. The other thing I think that's important here is that it allows us as researchers to check, when we're presenting qualitative data, that we are using all the data we have. What I mean by that is, I occasionally come across qualitative papers where the authors say they've done 10, 20, 30 interviews, but when I look at the data, they've only included data from 8 or 9 participants in their findings section and maybe over-relied on 3 or 4 of them. Beware of that. Try to avoid doing that. And if you've collected data from 30 people, try to make sure there's a bigger cross-reference than 3 or 4 people that you're constantly reusing as examples in your findings section. I think that's a very important thing to do. Try to avoid using very short extracts to illustrate major themes. The more important your point, the better the data needs to be. So the more crucial your point is, the stronger your data needs to be to actually support that. Just going back to data extracts, one of the things that I meant to say when I was talking about that and making sure that your full sample is represented as far as possible is, when you're condensing a thesis or a larger study into a qualitative paper, and obviously the results, the finding sections are being condensed, then that's an easy time for that mistake to be made. So make sure you're constantly looking at the data you are representing here. Before we move on to talk about the discussion, I want to talk a little bit about the combining of findings and discussion in qualitative research papers. Our methodology allows both approaches. I think my comments would be is that if the journal tends to publish papers that publish the findings and then the discussion separately, you should do that. If you're feeling brave, try to combine them. But my general advice is, play safe. Stick with the style that the journal uses. So if they combine findings and discussion in one section, then you need to do that. If they separate the findings from the discussion, I think that's probably the best course of action. We all want to be published ultimately, and I think making sure that our paper fits with the convention of the journal is one of the key ways to do that. Remember, when we're discussing our findings, not to be too ambitious. Remember, we're not trying to generalize too broadly with qualitative research. Try to present your findings, but also try to avoid generalizing. Be cautious. And be honest about the limitations of your study, and try to turn these into the need for further research. Most journals now will ask all authors to construct a section about the limitations of their study. I think these sections are often badly written, and they're also hurriedly written. I think you can write them in a way that acknowledges that the study does have its limitations, because any research study has its limitations. There's no such thing as the perfect study. But they can be written in such a way, such as the example I've got here on screen for you to read, where the shortcomings, if you like, or the limitations of the study are presented, but throughout some key themes are reiterated. So although the limitations are clear from this, I still mention the fact that the study provides some very useful data. It's an under-researched issue. I talk about the fact that further research could be helpful in this respect. And it's also important to acknowledge that this study, although small, still provides a unique perspective, and that other research would develop and enhance the findings of this study. So try to find some way of writing your limitations in the most positive kind of way. Remember, it's not your job to do the reviewer's task for them here. Try to be as positive you can about any limitations, and try to link it to the fact that your paper still presents useful data and is a benchmark and a launchpad for further research. In the end, that's what qualitative research should be all about anyway. In your discussion, remember your research question. What has your data added to the quantitative research on this topic? How has it deepened our understanding or dimensionalized our understanding? And then this next point is very important when we're talking about international journals. Small studies can still be made internationally important if they make some kind of contribution to an explanatory theory, concept, or major nursing issue. So the more you can discuss where your paper fits with, challenges, reinforces, or dimensionalizes a theory or a concept or major nursing issue or other kinds of health issue or other kind of subject field issue, the better, because that will make them attractive for international journals. And this is the section where you should stress the international relevance of your paper. And I think there are three questions that authors can ask themselves when they want to find out whether their paper is going to reach an international audience. And the first one is whether a reader in a region or country very different from your own will still be able to make sense of everything in your paper. We don't write for local audiences, we write for an international audience when we're trying to publish in peer-reviewed journals. Ask yourself whether you've clearly outlined the relevance of your paper to the subject field internationally. Is your literature search international? Is it transferable into other care settings, cultures, or nursing or other healthcare specialities? If your paper explores focus cultural or other specific issues, have you placed these discussions within an international context? So these three questions you should ask yourself, not when you've written the paper, but before you start. You should be constantly reminding yourself of these three questions as you write, because as editors of journals, we are very concerned with a paper's transferability to a different setting, culture, care environment. And if they're not, if they're more local, then that increases the risk of rejection, certainly from an international peer review journal. I've reached the last slide of my seminar this evening, and I hope that was useful. I'm really looking forward to now taking your questions and hearing some of the points that you like to make. But thank you very much for listening. It's been a pleasure to talk to you this evening, and I think it's time to hand back to Ricardo. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. So let me see if anybody has any questions for Ms. Dr. Hayter. Emerson, University of Illinois, do you have a question? Let me give you the microphone to you. Just a second, Emerson. Okay, your microphone is opened. Would you like to say something?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, very clearly. Go ahead.
Yes, I can. Hi, Professor. Thank you very much for your brilliant presentation, inspired from presentation. Thank what you. I'd like to know is that our laboratory now is working with a mix of methods with great portion with qualitative studies.
Yeah.
How we can address all these points that you mentioned in your presentation, knowing that now journals, most of the journals are reducing the number of words that you can place in a paper.
Yes. I'm afraid that's one of the biggest challenges. I think using tables is very helpful. But also with mixed methods, it may be possible to publish the quantitative and the qualitative results in linked papers, for example. That might be something that I think we're going to see more of, because I think there's more and more mixed methods research being done. And I agree with you, it's becoming a challenge. I think the other thing that we need to do is that now we're publishing more and more papers online that look for the journals that allow you to produce supplementary files. So although copy is very restricted in the paper journal, in this day and age now, most people do their literature searching and read journal papers online. Most journals now offer the opportunity for researchers to upload supplementary files that are available online for readers. So that's the second point I would make. And the third point is, and I've been doing this for a long time, and that's trying to lobby other editors to extend the word limits for maybe mixed methods papers. So maybe you should join in with me and make that a bit of a way forward for us.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I will now give the microphone to Laura. Laura, you have a question. Let me see if you have a working microphone, and then I will give it to Kyla. So let me see Laura here. Your microphone is open now. Laura Marcos?
Hello.
Yes. Laura Marcos? Well, I do not hear your voice, but I can read I can read her question, which is the following. Mark, she's saying this. In addition to writing for a specific journal and its editors and reviewers, I would appreciate your comments on writing for the journal's actual audience in terms of level, tone, knowledge of the subject matter, etc. Laura Marcos wrote that.
I'm sorry, would you mind repeating that, Ricardo?
Yes, of course. She said the following. Excellent points. In addition to writing for a specific journal and its editors and reviewers, I would appreciate your comments on writing for the journal's actual audience in terms of level, tone, knowledge of the subject matter, etc.
Okay, I mean, a couple of points there is, unfortunately, as authors, we are writing for editors and reviewers first and then our audience later. We will never get to our audience unless we write for editors and reviewers. That would be my first point. But as reviewers and editors, we're measuring the quality of papers and trying to ensure that the quality of papers in our journal is consistent. So my advice would be that you need to aim for the tone and the level of knowledge that is present in your target journal. So if they are spending a lot of time, for instance, explaining theories or concepts, then that's something you should do. Because don't forget that those published papers have gone through the quality appraisal system. They've been seen by editors. They've been edited. They've been reviewed. So the depth of information necessary, that information is there in the other journal papers. So make sure you read similar papers to yours in journals. And if you're trying to make a specific clinical point, then you go for a clinical audience in a clinical journal. Likewise, a theoretical point, a more academic point, should I say, you would probably want to pick a journal that had that as its focus. But you judge the level of your paper by the other papers in the journal. That it's a difficult question to answer, but that's the best I can do.
Okay, thank you. Let me see if anybody else would like to speak. I don't see any other written questions here. Let me see. Nobody else is raising their hands for questions. We have a total of 54 presenters, 53 at this moment. I mean, not presenters, but members of the audience. And let me see here. I see a hand raised. Let me check it. Just a second. Just a second here. Emerson, your hand is raised again. I wonder if you have a follow-up question. And also, Betania. So let me ask Emerson. Do you have a follow-up question, Emerson?
No. Actually, it's not a question. It's more I'm going to ask because I was trying to take some notes about the slides, but it was going too fast for me actually here. And I was wondering if this presentation is going to be available in elsewhere.
Yes. In fact, I can answer that. Normally, the presentations as well as the video recording of these seminars are going to are made available on the IIQM website under this program. So, but let me ask you. Yeah.
If anyone would like the slides, then my email is on screen. It should be there. If you would like to email me, I would happily send you a copy of this presentation.
Okay, thank you, Mark. As well as people can go to the IIQM website, and there they will get everything. Now, I have a question here from Betania, and I will give the microphone to her. Let me see if she has a working microphone. Just a second here. All right. Okay, Betania, would you like to speak? You have a question on sampling, you're saying, but I cannot hear your voice. Could you write down your question, please, in the questions pane on your computer? Anybody else?
Okay.
Yeah. Go ahead. Go ahead. Yeah, we can hear you very, very clearly. Go ahead.
Thank you. This is a really great and useful presentation. I was wondering, for example, when talking about the sampling procedures and the type of sampling used, would you suggest using terms for what type of sampling you did, like homogeneous or intensity sampling, or more of a description?
I think terms. When talking about the theory, I think it would be perfectly acceptable and recommend, you know, talking about snowball sampling or anything like that. And then when you move on to the second part, you can talk about the practicalities of how that was done. So, yeah, I think using terms is helpful.
Okay. Thank you very much. Anyone else? We still have 10 more minutes before the ending time of this presentation. Anybody else would like to ask a question to Dr. Hayter? Let me see here. Well, Carol, your hand is raised, so I will give you the microphone now. Carol,
can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
All right. I have a question about the inclusion of numbers in qualitative. I've worked in academic departments where they get very excited if you're going to put any kind of numbers in there, and I rather like to use numbers here and there to show strength of agreement in things or strength of opinion of, you know, a number of people that are involved in it. Mark, how do you feel about that?
I presume you're talking about maybe, you know, 20 out of 25 participants said or agreed with this or were positive in that kind of way. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, that's correct. It's when you've got your, if you're coming up with your themes and patterns and you're saying, you know, this one seems to be particularly important because it was something that was raised by 25 people, something along those lines.
Yes, I suppose what you're doing there, though, is you're setting yourself up for a reviewer saying, well, what about the other 10? how much does your thematic map, if you like, or your grounded theory, how much of it does it represent all of your participants? So I suppose there's that element. But I don't think it's something that I would disapprove of. I think, you know, the judicious use of numbers could be quite helpful. But beware of the fact that what about the other part of your sample?
Right, so there's maybe a need to address that part of it as well then.
Well, I think, yeah, or that there would be nothing wrong, for instance, and I think this comes out of the analytical process, is that a theme could have, well, positives and negatives, and 30 people talked about this in a positive way, however 10 thought of it in a different way, in a more negative way. But the theme could still be the same thing.
Right. Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes, yeah. I just wondered, you know, what your thoughts were on the inclusion of some numbers.
I have not got an objection to that. I'm not one of those qualitative researchers that hates numbers. I think they can be useful sometimes.
I think particularly in content analysis it's useful.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Thank you very much, Carol. And I will mute you now, and I will give the microphone to, and I may be pronouncing your name in the wrong way, so my apologies for that, but Nane or Nain Saduri, I will give you the microphone. Let's see if you can, if you have a working microphone. Okay, the microphone is open.
Okay, you pronounced it right, Dr. Contreras. This
Thank
presentation
you.
Is really helpful. As I use the Atlas, and we work for a grant for the Department of Public Health. So I haven't written articles for publication, but I have to our grantee. But my question is, in the procedures and analysis section, is it safe to just say you used Atlas.ti software, or does there need to be more detail for, I guess, the reader or the editor, such as explaining either step-by-step what you did or sort of the number of codes and how those came about?
I think it would be better to have a broader description rather than just saying you used Atlas. Just I think just one sentence is probably not going to be enough. I think what we have to remember is that these systems are tools for an analytical process. They don't do the analysis for us. We still have to use our minds. So I think it would be better, I think, to add a few words of description. I think methodology sections don't have to be very long, but I think the very short ones are probably problematic.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I am going to mute your microphone. Anyone else would like to ask questions? Let me see here. This is simply to add. Yes, Emily. I will give you the microphone, Emily. Perhaps you can say this out loud. Emily, your microphone is open. Okay, so I am going to read what she wrote. Okay, Emily, can you speak? All right, so I'm going to read what she wrote. She wrote the following. Let me see here. She wrote, this is simply to add to the response from Dr. Hayter in response to Carol's question. Depending on the demographic characteristics, a small number of people mentioning statements that refer to a theme should not be discounted, but could perhaps be grounds to recommend further research. Some participants are more eloquent than others, but it does not mean that a particular experience is not present in the experiences of the majority. That's what she said as a compliment to the conversation.
I would agree with that. A very sensible comment.
Okay, thank you very much. Now let me see. Emerson, I think he has something else to add. And I will open your microphone, Emerson, again. Go ahead. Okay, Emerson, there is a lot of background noise there. So if you would like to add something, could you write it down, please? And I will read that out loud. Let me try once again with your microphone. Let me open it up. Yes, go ahead, Emerson. No, too much noise. So if you could write it down, please, I will read it. Anybody else? Okay, we are coming to the end of this session. 4 minutes before we finish, I want to thank you, Dr. Hayter, for his presentation and for contributing to this very, very important program that we have, IIQM and Atlas.ti in partnership. We have this webinar series that reaches out to people from all over the world, people who perhaps do not have the opportunity to attend these seminars at their universities, but they can join here online and listen and watch these presentations from very important and well-known researchers. So thank you very much for accepting to contribute to the program, Dr. Hayter. And thank you everybody else for joining us on this session. People from many different countries, and that's always wonderful. You know, it always kind of surprises me how people can join from everywhere and participate in a common community. And now I would like to ask Yvette to say the final words. And Yvette, the microphone is open for you.
Hi, thanks, Ricardo. Thanks again, Mark. That was a really great presentation. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. I just want to mention that everyone should take a visit over to the IIQM website, iiqm.ualberta.ca. We've got workshops coming up, as well as our Qualitative Methods Conference next year is going to be in Australia, in Melbourne, so abstract submission is open for that. As well as our dissertation award, again, that's in collaboration with Atlas.ti. We are accepting submissions, so you can go to the IAQM website and submit and have a chance to win one of our dissertation awards.
Thank you very much, Yvette. Just one final word on my part. You know, it's a very good idea if you are teaching courses in qualitative methodology that you see a way of incorporating the seminars into your curriculum. You see, so that students can also attend this presentation. So keep that in mind as a possibility. So thank you everybody once again for joining us, and thank you, Dr. Hayter. And the recording will be available on the IIQM website, and I will also be sending it to you, to all of you, in the automated message that you will be receiving in a couple of hours from now. Thank you, everybody. Goodbye.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.